you all for coming. Our first reader, Carol.
Seem smarter, a little more elevated than just plain old language with when the short walk to higher understanding is taken seriously, or at least consciously, there soon appears no difference between ocean water and desert rain. They have sprung from the same source, hydrogen atoms connecting at the precise point on oxygen atoms. The premise can be taken as a given. In fact, it must be. For the sake of providing an organizing principle to our thoughts and actions, and when taken in this context, we are the result of both nature and culture. Neither came before the other or stands in a loftier place than the other. Better to think less of two sides of the same coin, but just the coin, the thing itself, in its entirety, complete as a sentence. There is an abiding beauty to be embraced in all the competing creation stories societies have devised. The beauty comes from the simplicity and ease with which dots are connected. In one such story that we're all familiar with, the word of an unseen God gave form to the world when it was a void, as the text put it. So at that starting point, the processes of fission and fusion began, entropy and convergence got their start as well, and all the matter in the universe began its swirling dance against a velvet backdrop of endless night that serves to illuminate a constantly breaking dawn. Taking these premises on faith as a given, we cannot fail to know on the most basic level that while we may not understand all life has to offer or withhold, there yet remains some unifying theme at play. As part of the world, we are part of everything that came before and will be part of everything that comes after. Maybe it's just a comforting fiction or perhaps the only solid truth worth holding on to, but if we are indeed anything at all, are a flashing, crashing, screaming, weeping, laughing, smashing, tearing, swearing, heaving, weaving, sliding into infinity, infinitely complex and ultimately quite simple bag of chemicals. At the very same time, we are a remnant of the Big Bang, made of darkness and indeed made of those first words.
at a certain point, God wanted company. But there was no empty space in this endless light. So he had to make one for his creation. In a great act of love, he took in a huge breath and contracted himself inwardly. This left a giant black mass in the otherwise bright light. And this is where he was going to create our universe. God crafted and placed 10 Two recent conversations have galvanized my thoughts. At Thanksgiving, a friend who seems to all outward appearances stable, successful, and happy, expressed the sense that as he nears retirement and looks at the breadth of his life, he wonders what was the point. Another, even closer to home, challenged the point of my own struggling incremental efforts to see and to somehow combat the sources of the damage of our social ills, poverty, the abuse of power, even the misguided hope for change. If we see ourselves as part of the sustaining light we reach for with every stereo namaskar, try to visualize a circling around that symbolic sun, whatever that source of energy and light and enlightenment might be. While the moon has no light of its own, it uses reflected light to lighten the night, and even when the sun is gone. Yes, we've seen what happens at the worst of times, yet we continue to strive for the best of times all of our lives. We know that constantly, despite all evidence to the contrary, good has never given up hope and never ceased to fight back against destructive powers. So each of us, no matter how small or pathetic our efforts, in order to keep our part of the deal and hold up our little corner of the fabric of civilization, can and will and must keep our reflected light shining against the darkness without being discouraged. But in the circling that I envision, it is clear that some lights shine and reflect back more than others. They belong to the inner circle, closer to the light. There are so many of these bright stars where you wonder what inspired them, how did their vision become so purified, as in the refinest fire. We can all name some, the ones where history, creativity, and character combine to move us all nearer to the light. But there's a next circle, and another, through space and time, and including us all. For instance, just by researching the names of our own New York City public schools, I found new role models to be inspired by, and others seem to cast themselves in my path just when I need them. Here are a few. So this Ella Baker, born in 1903, on December 13th, so she just turned 110. She led the fight to desegregate the New York City schools in the 20s, and after working for both the NAACP and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference with Dr. King, she returned to New York to become involved in grassroots community-based organizing, rejecting the centralized focus of the national organizations. Bayard Rustin, born in 1910, he waited 11 years from his first efforts with A. Philip Randolph to organize a march on Washington for jobs and racial justice. The catalyst was the momentum created by the new young orator, Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr., when they sensed that the stars were finally aligned in their favor. He also worked tirelessly for gay rights and even in India for independence. Where did these people come from? Another fascinating role model, W.E.B. Du Bois, was born in 1868 and died astonishingly in 1963. I love the image of him striding around the countryside of Tennessee in 1886 and 7, convincing local black farmers and country folk to send their children to his son's school. His accounts of the people he met, as well as updates from when he visited 10 years later, are so vivid and authentic, and bring me to two more educators. Carolyn Pratt, 1867 to 1954. She did much the same kind of outreach when she worked for the Bureau of Educational Experiments in New York City and founded the Play School on Beck Street, which is now City Country School on West 12th. Based on the work of John Dewey, Pratt believed that formal education should be delayed until age 7 and, I quote, she started to develop the theory that it was a child's natural desire to explore, discover, and learn by watching kids
retreating into the backwoods of Maine. Perhaps she's worried that I would tell her we don't allow dogs in the sanctuary, or challenge her husband's claim that he is Christ. But I don't do that. It's not who I am. Instead, I ask, can I pet your dog? And with a furtive nod, she gently pushes the dog forward, who sniffs and licks my fingers, and then nuzzles against her chest. The sounds of the service starting send me back to my seat, and within minutes of singing the words to the opening song, I forget about Christ and his wife and their little brown dog. But when it's time to pass the peace, I turn around, only to realize it's too late. Christ is gone. Christ is in the back of the church, and he lives outside these walls. When I was a little girl, my grandmother told me that Christ would come in disguise to confound the wise, and he would take on all kinds of garments to challenge our certainty that we know how he will look. Christ is standing on the bread line in front of the food truck, waiting to be served. Christ is sitting on the sidewalk on Black Friday in the middle of a long line of people, some without jobs, plenty with kids, and a million different worries about how they're going to finance Christmas because they don't have enough. When the store doors open, the crowd surges forward out of fear. Christ gets fear. He knows what it's like to be out in the cold, no room at the inn, and not enough money in your wallet. All the reasons why we grasp and pull at any kind of hope when hope starts to feel like an absentee father each month. My grandmother said that Christ would come in disguise to confound the lies and challenge our certainty that we know how he will look. King of kings, or Lord of love, or Christ is pouring hot coffee for truckers who park their rigs on the side of the road, and Christ is begging for change on a stall number 6 train and patiently stands clear of the closing doors until we lift our eyes to see him. Christ is the hand on the shoulder of the man who lost his son in Newtown, and Christ is holding the hands of Benjamin and Anna and Charlotte and all the little children who lost their lives that day. Sometimes Christ is not that serious. Sometimes Christ laughs and surrenders like a beach ball being tossed back and forth in the sun, like a little girl going whoosh down a slide or flying high in the air on a playground swing. And sometimes Christ is that bossy voice in the deli who bites into an everything bagel with tomatoes, lox, and onions and says, "Oh, that's good." Christ is a fusion of colors and everything that has ever existed in time. Sometimes Christ wears dreadlocks, and other times he cuts his hair close. And on some days, Christ is bald. At the Good and Plenty laundromat in Astoria, a woman is quietly folding a pile of cotton blue work shirts. Her right leg is twisted because of a stroke, and when she walks, it kind of half drags on the linoleum floor. And every so often, she takes a cream handkerchief from her bra to wipe the sweat from her brow. But when the light comes in through the front glass window, it fills her face, reveals the naked truth, bathes her like water, water does for babies at baptism, and reveals the naked truth that all of us are blessed and loved by God, no matter what garments we have on. We are light. Christ is light, and that light is within every one of us. Thank you. Introducing the very talented Janet Lang.
Long ago, before cats could meow and only talked, the world was a very different place. There were no planes or automobiles, so people got around on foot. Camel, mule, horse, or elephant. There was no electricity. Homemade candles were used to see at night, and fireplaces provided warmth and a place for cooking. Houses were built very differently, and there certainly weren't any skyscrapers like you see in New York City. Some people lived in stone houses cut out of the cliffs of mountains. Clothes were made simple, designed for long wear, and made by hand. Work consisted of spending a lot of time hunting, digging for whales, water, planting, and harvesting food, and exchanging valuables. Office jobs were unheard of. Families were called tribes back then, and in good times, there were lots of babies. One of the bad things I could think of that is like today was the feuds between tribes. The wars and killings that became a result of ignorance and hatred. Just like today, people started bickering over the stupidest little things. For instance, sometimes there was envy if one person's house was bigger than another's. Then there was jealousy if one woman tried to covet another woman's husband. Then there was greed if one pig-headed person wanted it all, and if she or he was a control freak, forget about it. There was war. People around the planet were behaving rather badly in general back then. In other words, there were throngs of evildoers and hardly any kind, generous, and loving people left. There was so much death, suffering, and destruction going on that God decided to send his only son, Jesus, to earth so that he could set an example of how a person should live. That's when Mary got pregnant and an angel let it be known that the Son of God was soon to be born. Pretty soon the word spread throughout the land and to three beautiful queens of the Orient. They decided to travel across the desert to Bethlehem, bringing gifts for the newborn Messiah. This is where our story begins. Queen Anna was having a hard time deciding what to wear. She had so many clothes. Well, she said, I'm definitely bringing the coat I made out of 100 colorful ties. Being a seamstress and Renaissance woman, she could make just about anything. She had the most interesting and beautiful array of clothes. I'll bring some frankincense along too. It's probably stinky in that manger where baby Jesus will be born. The night before, she had built a telescope to search the heavens for newborn stars and galaxies as a way of guiding their journey on Earth. I'm going to give baby Jesus some of my gold necklaces, Queen Karen explained. Well, it's a good thing, said Queen Lina. You have too much gold as it is. It seems you get a gold present from one of your admirers every weekend after you perform. Not that I'm jealous, mind you, she said as she poofed her beautiful thick black hair with a sleek long arm and fingers. I hope you canceled all your December singing engagements. Yes, I have. Queen Karen, my next gig isn't until February 14th, Valentine's Day, when I perform for the Venus Society. That must be the Star of Bethlehem, said Karen with a look of wonder in her eyes. She looked especially beautiful tonight, long blonde hair framed an attractive petite thoughtful face. Her excitement for this journey was evident. Wait, wait, cried Queen Lena, I forgot my present for baby Jesus. She quickly and delicately wrapped the myrrh in a silk scarf and packed it in her saddlebag. What is this stuff anyway? The other two shrugged her shoulders and dumbfounded. Mary will know what to do with it, said Queen Anatina. Soon the three queens were on their way, and they rode three horses packed with saddlebags. Three camels loaded with provisions followed behind. The night was still and cool. A slight breeze ruffled their colorful headdresses. The caravan was making its way east and at a rapid pace, when at about dawn, a horrible scream that sounded like a yowl startled everyone off their horses. The leading horse of Queen Anatina had suddenly, accidentally, stomped on something. What was that? The others asked as they rushed up front to check on Anatina. Looks like my horse squashed this poor little creature, said Anatina. I think it's a pussycat, poor thing. Karen, would you get a splint and some bandages from the medicine bag? I might have broken its leg. In her adept manner, Queen Anatina delicately wrapped makeshift baby pouch. The caravan rode on as the brilliant sun rose ahead of them. Hues of orange and yellow smeared the horizon. The oasis and watering hole of Mullibuzzolan was barely visible in the distance, probably 10 miles or so. They would be there around noon when the sun was at its strongest, and a good thing, too, they were tired, hungry, and thirsty and needed to rest. When taking a short break within a few miles of the oasis, a funny thing happened. A striking black sleek cat with beautiful yellow eyes sauntered over and plopped down on the side in the sand right in front of them as if to say, "Take me, I'm yours." Whereupon a tall and handsome sheep with long braids pulled back from an intelligent, sensitive face strode over and apologized for the cat's behavior. Then she can be a bit much, but she needs her adoration constantly, even from strangers, exclaimed the elegant, charming man. "Where are you off to?" he asked after introducing himself as Sheik Hunkadok. "A Messiah is soon to be born in Bethlehem," replied Karen. "From Mullibuzzolan, we are heading east to the next watering hole, which I believe is about here." She pointed her finger on a spot in the scrolled map. "That is a treacherous part of the desert to be traveling through without protection," said she. "Hunkadok," he solemnly replied. "I've heard from time to time desert bandits ford the wells around there. And if the three of you don't mind, Demshi and I would be delighted to escort you safely to Bethlehem." "Really, would?" agreed Queen Lena and Karen in unison with a faint air of helplessness. Queen Yanatina just smiled thoughtfully. She was used to independently fending for herself, and in her work as a sage and healer, smart and handsome men were a dime a dozen. Soon the caravan was off again into the desert, only this time Sheik Hunkadok took the lead. On his head, he wore a white rectangular scarf with a black and jeweled headband. There was something very exquisite yet modest about his behavior, as if he didn't have to prove himself to anyone. This confidence, combined with his height and good looks, made him extremely desirable. Twilight approached. The magical calf Demshi scouted ahead of the horses, making sure that the way was safe from dangerous sand traps and any hibernating critters. The calf being totally black, the sheik had only her yellow, phosphorus eyes to follow. Queen Anatina was still nursing the broken leg of Ninochka Bambina. Lena and Karen trailed behind. After traveling all night into the wee hours of the morning, a scattered hue of green from palm leaves slowly became visible on the hot horizon. The sheik was truly an experienced guide and seemed to know his way around the desert, even by night through the stars. It was almost midday before our weary travelers emerged upon the small mountainous village. Before they arrived at the square of Habib's watering hole, loud voices were heard arguing. "Damn straight. If you want water for your herd, give me 2 whole pieces now," shouted a disheveled, angry ruffian. He looked mean and not to be messed with, especially with the long sword he had carried in a sheath down to his feet. "How dare you try and extort coal for water?" cried a kind-looking man with a cook's apron on. "The water in this desert is a natural resource from God. Never has anyone paid for water." "Well, we'll pay now. 20 years ago, I built this well. Now I'm collecting for my neighbor," hollered the mean one, and he suddenly drew his sword in a lightning quick motion, placing its tip under the cook's chin. Then before you could say, "Boop," a huge black and furry cat with white paws and a tuxedo chest jumped out of nowhere and onto the face of the man with the threatening sword. The man dropped his sword, screaming bloody murder as blood trickled down his face. Though he reeled in circles, trying to remove the cat from its head, it was no use. This was one big monster with claws, cutting his ruffian face to smithereens. Sheik Hunkadok dismounted and picked up the sword from the ground. He waited until the man's face was scratched to a pulp and lay sobbing in the sand. "I think it best you leave this village as soon as you get cleaned up and packed. Otherwise, you may not make it through the night." The sheik placed the sword in his own sheath and led the others to a nearby stable. A bunch of villagers crowded around to following young Wheeler star. Villagers held hands and danced around her while she sang. A boisterous and joyful time was had by all. Meanwhile, a cool twilight emerged. The moon rising in all its round brightness. Ninotchka Bambina lay in Anatina's bed with the cast still on her broken leg. She was dreaming of mice and women when a key fumbled in the lock to the queen's door. Light from the hall spilled into the room. A bandaged and ugly face peered around the door. Ninotchka Bambina awoke with a start, let out a banshee yell that terrified the intruder so much he scampered and ran uncontrollably, stumbled and fell head over heels down the back stairs and broke his neck at the bottom. This incorrigible, terrible man was found dead the next morning by Habib's helper. Ninotchka recounted the incident by saying, somehow he got hold of the master key, and I know for sure he was attempting to rob Queen Karen of all her gold. Listen to one who knows. I'm not the boss of the Bambina crime family for nothing. Queen Anatina thanked Ninotchka for protecting the precious gifts for their messiah. Soon the queens were packed and ready for the final day's journey. Monsieur Black decided to accompany the travelers. Secretly, this cat had a desire to be with Bemshi the scout. The two felines were now indeed strolling side by side. So how did you hook up with Sheik Hunkadok, Monsieur Black asked. Oh, I was doomed to be a prisoner in my previous owner's wine cellar, replied Bemshi. Would you believe that family thought it good for me to just chase and eat mice the rest of my life in darkness, never to see the light of day? One time the sheik was checking out their vintages when he spotted me crying in self-pity over my bondage. He's the one who rescued me and let me out of the cellar. Wow, cried Monsieur Black. Thank God some people have compassion for animals. When I was a kitten, I was beaten, hauled off, and left in the desert to die just because I was a little promiscuous. I couldn't help it if I was a cat man. He gave Nimshi one of his debonair flirtatious smiles, and she almost did the plot right there on the spot. The caravan wound its way through some hills and the final stretch of the desert that eventually led to Bethlehem. They could barely see the town a few kilometers away when a sandstorm hit them hard, and the wind almost ripped off their headdresses, and sand flew in every crevice in their face. Now you know why nomads from the Orient have slanted eyes, said Bemshi, squinting as the sand whipped all around her. It was rough going at a snail's pace, but these courageous, spiritually devoted travelers finally made it. It was approaching midnight when they spotted a small crowd near a stable on the outskirts of town. Is this where Mother Mary and Joseph are staying? Inquired Queen Anatina to a woman walking along the road. Yes, yes, she exclaimed with excitement. Isn't it wonderful? Let's go see newborn Jesus. They unloaded their gifts, and a pleasant innkeeper took care of their horses and camels. Mary was holding the sleeping Messiah in her arms with such a look of love and tenderness that made everyone's eyes shimmer. A gentle gathering sat in the straw around Mary and Joseph. The people mostly whispered to one another how blessed they felt about being there in Jesus' presence. The three queens individually placed their gifts alongside other presents next to Jesus' wooden cradle. The manger was charged with such a spirit of sweet love, warmth, and peacefulness, it made your heart sing. The three queens looked across the barn, and wouldn't you know it, there they saw three old bearded kings bearing gifts as well. It was quite a moment in time, and to this day, that is why we symbolically give gifts to one another for Christmas, to celebrate Jesus' birth. God sent Jesus to earth to absolve everyone of their sins, to teach, and to set an example on how to live in this world. Two most important things Jesus said are to love God and to love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. The queen started singing in beautiful three-part harmony. We three queens of Orient are bearing gifts, we travel afar, moor and mountain, field and fountain, following yonder star. Thank you.
found myself on 7th Avenue South and Downing Street, right in front of the Blue Ribbon Bakery. I pop in for a bite to eat. On their premises, bread ovens always roaring, and the food prepared by master chef duo brothers Eric and Bruce Bromberg. On a snowy night is a perfect setting. As I sat sipping a brandy newly arrived from France, I spotted the most alluring, sensuous-looking place. A simple, small sign said Bardot. Now, I must tell you, I've been to the Blue Ribbon Bakery many times. The manager, Andrew Scarzi, and I know each other from the days of the Derby. He and I would sit and chat and talk about the good old days. I had never noticed this place, Bardot. Just the name alone was a draw for me. It certainly didn't look large or crowded. From my seat in the restaurant, peering through the snowflakes, I could see a DJ, a bar with four stools, two couches very close to the floor, and three lit candles, black, white, and yellow. I sipped and looked while saying to myself, I got to go. I must go. I must go soon. The sheer mystery surrounding Bardot was a draw for me. I leave Blue Ribbon Bakery, I go to Bardot. The entrance is attended to by this big, bluxom blonde named Loretta. Yes, Loretta, not Hazel, Martha, Mary Ann, but Loretta. After passing the big L, as she became known to me, I stood in the middle of the most sensuous place I had been in a while. The blackness of the interior of Bardot, dancing amid the flickering white candlelight, strategically placed about, commanded the spirits, the inner demons. Oh, I danced. I danced, I let my body go, and I followed where it led. I danced on the black low tables, I rolled on the sofas, I prayed to the gods of others as I danced on the walls. The throbbing beat of the music drove me further into the cracks and crevices of Bardot. Oh, I danced with no one in particular, for it was only myself, the DJ, and Big L. Just as I reached that epicenter of no return, Big L taps me on the shoulder and says, last call, honey. Reality grounds me once again as I gather myself and gently ease back into the beautiful snowstorm. But I shall never forget that night at Bardot. This is written in memory of and for the anniversary of 26 missing pieces of our human puzzle, lest we forget to keep their lights alive. Welcome to the theater of life. Step right in, come directly down to the aisle to your seat. Ah, which seat you say? There are only four choices. Center section, rows L, I, F, E. The curtain opens on Newtown, Connecticut. The date is 12/13/12. Yes, 12/13/12. There comes a point in everyone's life where you have to step up, where you become or stay a detached American, you know, one of the three monkeys. You can choose to not accept the task of being in charge of your neighbor, or you can be the exception, not decline the task. Picture Sandy Hook. My next door neighbor, Jackie, has a son, John, cute, early 20s. I heard he was being homeschooled. I really like his neat afro. His mother often takes him to the range, I heard from Police Chief Smith. Sally at the beauty parlor tells me that his mom was in the other day for a trim. That's the only haircut she could possibly get there with that type of hair. And don't you know, she went on and on about the new gun she bought her son. Child, Ann and Alan, the next door neighbors, on the left, were down at Bill's Bar and Grill, talking about how the windows of the basement are blacked out. Making a joke about blacks having blacked out windows. A hush falls over the bar. Wait a minute, hold Joe gives him some very interesting info on the hours spent, the voluminous amount of weaponry for a mother and son. Needless to say, Police Chief Smith proceeds to Jackie and John's house. The weapons are confiscated. 26 children and teachers go to school. 26 children and teachers come home. End of story. Now.
Turns onward, I keep going, reaching, spreading, going always.